my pleasure at this time to introduce someone who, of course, needs no introduction. And I have a long speech to give before I invite her up, but no, I do not. My main job is to say, please welcome Mayor Linda Gorton to give out of the annual budget address.
Thank you very much, Vice Mayor. Good afternoon, everyone. And again, Vice Mayor Kay, thank you very much. Welcome to our council members, most of whom are here today. And council members, you are partners in this budget process, as you know. And many of your priorities are reflected in my budget proposal. Council will weigh my budget plan carefully and propose changes they feel are important. Ultimately, they will pass a budget that represents both administrative and legislative goals. Council members, thank you to all of you. I appreciate you. So the budget I am presenting today is bold. It's a historic investment in our community. In two of my previous budgets, I have made painful cuts we needed to live within our means during challenging times. This year, we have an unprecedented opportunity to invest in our future, to address pent-up needs, and to plan for future obligations. To reflect lessons I learned managing the pandemic, but also to move forward and overcome the impact of COVID-19. To make significant progress, especially in public safety and affordable housing. I want to take you through this budget, talking about the investments it makes and the mix of funding that makes them possible. And before I get started with that, I want to thank my budget team that helped me put this budget together. It took an experienced, knowledgeable team to craft a budget of this size and complexity. Our team was led by Chief Administrative Officer Sally Hamilton and my Chief of Staff, Tyler Scott. My Commissioner of Finance, Erin Hensley, and her team were an essential, critically important part of this process. This group knows how to make the most of our resources, how to meet our responsibilities, prepare for future costs, while also striking out in new directions. So let's start by talking about our resources. This year, they are significant and exceptional. Our general fund budget totals $460 million. This is a one-time phenomenon that involves one-time money we won't have next year. Therefore, we have been very careful to match one-time money with one-time investments. And I want to say that one more time. There's significant one-time money in this budget, money we don't expect next year, and we are investing it in costs we won't have again next year. Our budget is a mix of several revenue streams. It includes our projection for $42 million in new revenue, reflecting strong growth in our economy, $12.6 million in savings from this year we are carrying forward, $12.5 million from current budget stabilization. We are using this money to meet pressing needs. This fund has outlived its usefulness in a budget that, thanks to our intentional, conservative fiscal management, already has a healthy rainy day fund. Savings totaling $2.7 million in various accounts that have built up over the years. And a modest $42 million bond. Our careful management of debt has kept our borrowing costs low with a continued AA stable bond rating, despite the financial turbulence of recent years. Look behind several of these numbers and you will find the impact of the pandemic. It put our economy on a roller coaster ride in 2020, dramatically slowing virtually all economic activity. We benefited from considerable federal and state investment to help us recover. Just 2 years later, our economy is at pre-pandemic levels and beyond. $42 million in new revenue tells the story of that recovery in dollars and cents. The city helped the economic recovery with support for the business community, rent and utility assistance, provision of personal protective equipment, and more. And our business community stepped forward with new investments, expansions, and new jobs that reflect their faith in our city and its economy. The question every Lexington budget answers is, how do we use our revenue to meet the most pressing needs and invest in our future? This is a question we weigh every year, and there are always many answers. My answer always starts with investments in public safety, so that's what I'm going to talk about first. Increases in youth gun violence, domestic violence, and homicides have been part of the fallout from COVID-19 for cities across America. As the leader during this pandemic, I have had to find answers that fit our city. One of the answers is the refocusing and expanding of One Lexington, our program designed to reduce gun violence among young people. Archbishop Desmond Tutu once said, "We need to stop just pulling people out of the river. We need to go upstream and find out why they're falling in." In a nutshell, that's the goal of One Lexington. Divine Karama, our director of One Lexington, has spent many years both pulling people out of the river and finding out why they're falling in. The work was his calling long before he came to my office almost a year ago. With support from the city, One Lexington is already having quite an impact on youth on our streets and in our schools. In Divine's first 10 months in the mayor's office, it has become clear that One Lexington needs more resources. I've added approximately $375,000 to One Lexington's budget to build partnerships across government and throughout our city. Partners will become involved in programs like the It Takes a Village summer program, a grant program for violence intervention, youth mediation, street outreach, and evidence-based programs that address trauma. I have also added a new person in my office to support the work of One Lexington and expand its impact. In addition to working with a number of community partners, One Lexington works with our first responders and with Parks and Recreation and Social Services. Parks is offering a new interactive summer experience for youth this year, an opportunity for teens to learn about the transition from middle school to high school or high school to college, community leadership, and technology. In addition, this summer there will be recreation leaders in 16 neighborhood parks to provide and supervise a wide variety of new activities for ages 5 and older. And Social Services is expanding its summer youth job training program. 300 young people will have the opportunity to earn a salary and learn more about the world of work. All these efforts positively impact youth and expose them to strong role models and opportunities. While it's too early to assess the full impact of One Lexington and other new youth programming, our violent crime numbers here in Lexington are leveling off, thanks to the outstanding work of our community-focused police department and our community partners. Even so, we all know one homicide is one too many. We are expanding our efforts to support our police with significant new resources. Law enforcement is facing challenges to keeping us safe, unlike ever before, and it is incumbent on us to invest in modern equipment to help them do their jobs. With the help of council, we recently began a pilot project for the Flock license plate readers. Flock started installing the first 25 still cameras just last month, and they are already proving to be effective. Police have already used them to locate and arrest suspects related to domestic violence and other assaults, recover stolen vehicles, and help identify a suspect in an animal abuse investigation. I want to have the funds in place to expand the Flock project, assuming the pilot license tag cameras continue to succeed. I've included $275,000 in this budget for an additional 75 Flock cameras to be scattered throughout our community. Let me be very clear about this. These are not cameras for speeding tickets. These tools aid our law enforcement professionals in investigations and help them solve crimes. In addition, we will spend $5 million to replace police vehicles. We invest in public safety equipment each year to ensure it is up to date. Clearly, that investment also extends to our fire department. This year, we will make a significant investment in state-of-the-art technology, $1.2 million, to install a fire station alerting system. Accurate and timely response is a top priority for our fire department. This is a more reliable system that will get our firefighters out of the stations quicker. We will take a huge step forward in purchasing fire equipment, modernizing our fleet, and reducing fleet downtime. I have budgeted $6.1 million for 3 engines, 2 emergency medical units, 1 ladder truck, and a mobile air vehicle used to refill air cylinders at fire scenes. Now, we all agree that public safety is the foundation of a healthy community. There are other essentials we must add to that foundation if we want to build a successful community. Near the top of that list is the need for an ample supply of quality, affordable housing. The pandemic revealed the depth of the need, and cities all over the country are feeling the impact. In Lexington, we continue to grow. People want to live here, and they need housing they can afford. As the only mayor who has led the city during a pandemic in modern history, I am well versed in the demands it has put on housing. While as a city, we can't do anything about the rising costs of construction or higher interest rates, we can build more affordable housing, and that's what we're proposing. This is the first full budget year for our new Department of Housing Advocacy and Community Development, led by Commissioner Charlie Lanter. Since 2014, when we created our Affordable Housing Fund, the city has committed millions of dollars each year to provide funding to for-profit and nonprofit developers to create or preserve almost 3,000 units of affordable housing. The city has leveraged $23.6 million in government funds into a total investment of $350 million in affordable housing in our community. This is an astounding record. This year, we are taking the government's commitment to affordable housing to the next level. The council and I committed $10 million in American Rescue Funds to affordable housing. And in this budget proposal, I'm proposing the addition of $2 million more for our affordable housing fund. In addition, I am proposing the establishment of a $1 million Lexington Neighborhood Infrastructure Investment Fund. Organizations will be able to apply for zero interest loans to rehabilitate blighted and abandoned properties, turning them into affordable housing and combating gentrification. We also are hoping to improve housing through a fund we established in code enforcement, now a part of our housing department. The $200,000 Housing Assistant Program provides home repair grants to low-income homeowners who can't afford to make needed repairs. Although we will fund most homelessness-related initiatives outside this budget through American Rescue funding, I think it's important to talk about them in this speech since it is part of our affordable housing. The council and I have dedicated $5.75 million in American Rescue funding to homelessness. Good jobs are also required if we are going to build a robust city. We work on economic development every single day. Numbers that reflect the state of our economy speak for themselves. We are back to pre-pandemic levels and then some. Consider this. Almost 1,000 more businesses, many of them operating remotely, now have employees in Lexington than were here before the pandemic. Or this. In early March of 2020, our unemployment rate was 3.7%. In April of 2020, our unemployment rate skyrocketed to 14.8%. Right now, our unemployment rate is hovering around 3%, lower than the rate before the pandemic. There are several initiatives in economic development funding I have included in this budget. First, a $3 million infrastructure investment fund to lessen barriers to infill development. While there is significant property available for development within our urban services boundary, we must recognize that it can be more expensive to develop infill property. This fund will provide repayable zero interest loans designed to be the last money in to make an infill project work. I've also included funding for a sustainability study to maintain the database of how much land is available for housing, economic development, commercial, and other uses. In addition, we are investing to put city permitting requirements online, a one-stop shop. This will make it quick and easy for everyone, from land development professionals to do-it-yourself homeowners, to find out what permits are needed, what they'll cost, and even apply for permits online. Lexington is business-friendly, and we will continue to knock down barriers and streamline processes. As part of our economic development efforts, we have been working for 3 years to lay the groundwork to make Lexington a hub of high-tech agricultural innovation. We've done the studies, and we've talked to our local network of ag tech firms. As we have worked on this issue, we have formed a strong partnership with Kentucky Agriculture Commissioner Dr. Ryan Quarles, Dr. Nancy Cox, Dean of the University of Kentucky College of Agriculture, Food, and Environment, and Alltech President, Dr. Mark Lyons. Now, we are establishing a public-private partnership, the Bluegrass AgTech Development Corporation, to provide for staff, locations, incentives, and challenge grants. In this budget, I am pledging $1 million toward these efforts. Our partners have also expressed an interest in working with the Kentucky Agriculture Development Board for additional funding and support for this effort, which will be a sustainable effort forward. I've also included in the budget $2 million for PDR program to protect our working farm businesses. Now, let's talk about basic services, always a core part of my budget. Since it seems we're finally beyond the really cold weather, maybe, let's talk about snow. We're replacing our worn-out original salt barn, buying a salt brine maker to ensure a ready supply, and doing a study to optimize our snowplow routes. Like snow removal, Streets and Roads also oversees our paving projects. And this year, we've included $13 million for paving. There are two significant road projects in this budget that I want to talk about today. First, we are supporting Fayette County Public Schools by widening the intersection of Mason Headley at Versailles Road. The schools have purchased property in this area for a new school. Road improvements are essential, and this is a total $3.6 million project. This year, we are funding the design at $1.37 million. Second, I have set aside $5 million for safety improvements on High and Manchester Streets near Central Bank Center. There have already been too many crashes in this stretch of road. The expansion of Central Bank Center, the new Town Branch Park, and new businesses on what has served as the Lexington Center parking lot will increase traffic in this area. These funds will be used as a grant match or to fund public improvements. And speaking of traffic, we're investing $100,000 to continue our neighborhood traffic management program to allow traffic engineers to work with council members and neighborhood representatives to address neighborhood traffic concerns. Now, let's talk about some projects I've included that focus on quality of life. Many citizens discovered our pedestrian and bike trails and bike-friendly streets during the pandemic. It was a way to enjoy the outdoors safely. We've been working on this trail network for several decades, and it's a great asset for our city. Now we're beginning to make connections between trails. This year, we're improving curbs and sidewalks on North Limestone between Withers Avenue and New Circle and creating bike-friendly areas. Installing sidewalks and bike lanes on West Loudoun from North Broadway to North Limestone. Connecting Town Branch Trail and Legacy Trail from Lucille Drive to the proposed Village of Great Acres. And adding a much-needed shared-use path on Alumni Drive from Tates Creek Road to New Circle. The pandemic put a spotlight on the need for improved translation services and better outreach to offer a better quality of life to our growing immigrant community. We are spending $200,000 for two new full-time staff people at Global Lex and to provide for web translation. Residents will be able to push a button and convert our web pages into any of 94 different languages. Our extended social resource program Grants to social service agencies that provide essential quality of life services will be funded at $3.8 million this year, an increase of almost $200,000 over last year. These are important grants that fund partnerships with dozens of agencies across our community to help those who need it most. The assistance of these agencies has been invaluable during the pandemic. Following a recommendation from the Mayor's Commission on Racial Justice and Equality, we are spending $260,000 to buy a mobile food truck and refrigerated trailer that will sell fresh food in areas of town where fresh produce is difficult to find. This is a one-time upfront cost to get this program up and running. Going forward, our partners will stock and operate the vehicle. After more than 2 years of living with a pandemic, investments in health are more important than ever. Our Arboretum, the State Botanical Garden, a joint project between the city and the University of Kentucky, is raising money to renovate and expand its Education and Visitors Center. The Arboretum enhances quality of life for literally thousands of citizens. We will contribute $200,000 to that capital campaign. For the growing number of people who enjoy golf courses, I've included $750,000 to replace golf carts at Kearney Hills, Lakeside, Picadome, and Tate's Creek. Our junior and adult golf programming is experiencing record participation. We're also sprucing up for the Breeders' Cup races, which we will host this November. Among other projects, we will be refreshing the beds we established when we first hosted the Breeders' Cup in 2015. We will be ready to once again step into the international spotlight. Finally, it is our responsibility to take care of the people our government employs and the technology that makes government work. First, our employees. We have included a 5% raise for our non-sworn employees. Our employees in police, fire, or corrections unions have already received raises through collective bargaining. Government is a service organization. Our employees provide the expert services our residents demand. We want to ensure that we take care of our employees, and that means paying them fairly. We have to compete in a very tough labor market. So we are in the middle of a compensation study and have set aside in the budget $5 million to implement the findings of that study. Second, technology. The city makes continuous investments in cybersecurity. We are replacing an aging mainframe and securing 30 years of data the city is required to maintain. Finally, today, I want to talk about funding I have included to commission two important pieces of art. First, a memorial to commemorate our community's COVID-19 victims. To date, there have been 597 deaths of our people. We have found the perfect place for it downtown in a park that is part of Town Branch Commons. Families and friends will be able to visit, and in this public space, we will all find a place where we can remember our losses. Second, art to celebrate the 250th anniversary of our city coming up soon in 2025, our sestercentennial. Can you believe it? 250 years? We're older than the Declaration of Independence. Naturally, through our first quarter of a millennium, we've had our ups and downs. What's important is that in the end, we have made progress in building a wonderful community. Even as I led our city through the darkest days of the pandemic, I knew our community would ultimately triumph. Through 250 years, our citizens have risen to meet every test, and these memorials will mourn those we have lost, celebrate our past, and challenge us for the future. A future that, with determination and hard work, we will make bright for everyone. Thank you very much.